Hey, Rachel.
Hey, Brian.
So how was your week?
Well, I'm pretty psyched because Infrastructure Week came finally, and it's just in time because this was the week that you and I finally reconvened after over a year of being apart. We went to the Hall & Oates concert last night at Jones Beach, an outdoor venue, and we had to coordinate all these logistics, and it required taking the Long Island Railroad and meeting and driving to some random town. And it occurred to me that what is really needed from this infrastructure bill is a tunnel that goes directly from my house in West Hampton to Jones Beach. Or maybe, like, what if there was like a zip line so I could just like fly right in and avoid all that chaos, or a pneumatic tube?
Right. So anyone who says that the infrastructure is the like domain of the of privilege, like, here's an idea for you. Let this
infrastructure is for everybody.
It's for everyone,
including me.
Okay, I can't go for that.
No can do.
This is Nope,
the podcast where we shut it down.
We're just a couple of New York Jews talking about the news, beating back the blues. We made a podcast and here's why. Had to laugh so we don't cry. Come and join us for the ride. Welcome to Nope.
So, Rachel, we have a very unique episode. It's kind of a hybrid because we're going to have all the good Nopes that we normally have about the news and so forth. But since we went to Hall & Oates, we're going to talk a lot about that because it left a huge impact on us. And we think that people need to hear about it. Like, they're demanding to
hear
about
it. Whether they want to hear about it or not, they're going to hear about
it. So you're going to get a lot of Hall & Oates content in this podcast. More than you ever thought you wanted in 2021.
You needed it is what's the right. Weird thing.
You'll thank us in the end. So as a preface, before I was so excited for this concert, I was telling anyone who would listen that I was going for a month. I was saying we'd go to Hall & Oates, going in Hall & Oates. And some of the kids don't know who it is, but maybe they know a song or two. And I told my parents that I was going to Jones Beach Theater, where I had been in as a teenager and in college a few times. I actually saw Don Henley and Edie Brickell in the New Bohemians there.
Oh,
it was
yeah.
quite a show. So I told them that I was going to Jones Beach Theater, and they both like leapt out of their chairs and said, "Oh, we used to go to Jones Beach Theater." And I'm like, "Who did you?" Because this was probably like they were teenagers, like the late 50s, early 60s. And I'm like, "That'd be amazing. Who'd you see? Like Chuck Berry or Elvis Presley or someone like that?" And my dad goes, "No, I saw Song of Norway there." And I'm like, "What the fuck is Song of Norway?
The finest production in all of the land."
He's like, "No, that was a hot ticket back then, Song of Norway." And my mom goes, "Oh my God, I saw Song of Norway at Jones Beach too." And they had both seen it at Jones Beach.
Were at the same show together. They were probably sitting next to each other and they didn't even know they were going to get married.
Possibly. So I did a little research into Song of Norway, and as you do, and it turns out that it's an operetta that dates from 1944, and it's the story of Edvard Grieg, the great Norwegian composer. It ran for 526 performances, starring the great Lawrence Brooks as Edvard Grieg.
Not all of them at Jones Beach, right?
No,
or
but
well, no,
1944 was on Broadway. There was a revival at Jones Beach in the 50s and 60s. And that performance is recognized as one of the great performances. And it is the soundtrack recording. It's on the Masterworks Broadway label. And I listened to it, and it has hits that everyone will know, such as Freddie and His Fiddle. And, and Nordrock's Farewell. It's packed full of hits.
It's memorable.
It's like a Hall & Oates album.
Yeah,
and then just to wrap that up, I realized that a little after Doug and I had met, we realized that we had both been to see a revival of Anything Goes at Lincoln Center, starring the great Patti LuPone, in 1988. We had both been to the same show, and it was very impactful for both of us. And we realized that we had seen that, and it was a great bond between us. And we actually got a copy of the original poster from that show, and it now hangs in our home.
That's so cool. Josh and I were both at the same Grateful Dead concert at the Philly Spectrum in, like, 1993.
Wow. Very different from Anything Goes. But we have the poster, and admittedly, it's in our bathroom, but it's there. Yeah. It's in a place of honor. So, Rachel.
But you're burying the lead, Brian. You're burying the lead. Like, Okay. Why were we at the Hall & Oates concert? Let's talk about that.
We were at the Hall & Oates concert because I forgot your birthday, which is in February.
Yes.
And I also, to be honest, like I normally spend a lot of money on concerts, and I, you know, hadn't spent a dime on concerts in the last year and a half, 2 years. And I said, you know, let's splurge. Let me take Rachel to the concert she deserves. And not
Thank
only am
you.
I going to do
amazing.
This, but we're going to get the best seats that money can buy. And
the best parking spot. The best.
we'll get into that. We'll get into that. So we're going to tell a little bit of the story now. We'll tease it. And then because we go into detail, we're going to save the rest for the end. So if you want to skip the rest of the Hall & Oates story, you could just stop listening at the end. But we hope it's intriguing enough that you'll listen to the rest of the Hall & Oates saga. So Rachel, why don't you kick off the story here?
Well, aren't you going to talk about like your day, like what's leading up to it? Because you were late. The point, like I arrived at Babylon, which is where we were going to meet.
Right. So the thing is, if we're just going to drive from New York City to Jones Beach at rush hour, it was going to take 3.5 hours, according to Waze. So I'm like, not acceptable. So I concocted this whole multi-step plan where I went to my hometown, Port Washington. I saw my family. There was a doctor's appointment. There was a Chinese restaurant involved. There was a whole schmigoo. And then finally, I made it onto the road, and I took two different wrong turns. Instead of getting on the Northern State going the right way, I got on the Long Island Expressway going the wrong way because I have terrible sense of direction, and I can barely read when I'm on the road. And finally, I get to our appointed meeting place, Babylon, the town of Babylon.
Babylon, the town of Babylon.
The Hanging Gardens of Babylon. But I'm 20 minutes late, but I'm a very prompt person, so I was having like a
You're like
apologizing,
freaking out, and I'm like, oh, it's beautiful. Like I took the Long Island Railroad. I get out of Babylon. I'm like taking a nice stroll. I meet you at this restaurant. I had done some research in advance of like, what is the finest dining Babylon has to offer. So I found a few options, which I sent to you. There was a taqueria with outdoor seating. There was this wine bar and an Italian restaurant that was very tempting because it was billed on TripAdvisor as being perfect for a funeral luncheon. So we almost went to that one.
And then I nixed the Mexican food because I said, I can't control myself. I'm going to eat chips and guac and I'm going to be stuffed. And that's, I don't want to go to a concert.
You're
going to
wind
so
up like under the bridge, like somewhere.
Shooting heroin. It's a gateway drug. So we decided on the wine bar, but then I looked it up on like Google or Yelp reviews, and it said, I love this restaurant. I love the service. The only problem was that when I sat at the table, the silverware was wrapped up in a cloth napkin, and I unrolled the silverware, and like a wad of human hairballs fell out.
I mean, I feel like it's unfair though, because our experience was not like that at
all.
Well,
I know, but that was the point. I was apprehensive. So I was like, this is the choice we have, a funeral parlor,
or
a bingitorium, or a place whose finest menu item is a wad of human hair.
So we chose the human hair. And so I found it. It was delightful. I found a really nice table outside. I sat down. I ordered a glass of rosé. And just like as I was about to take the first sip, there you were, like a vision. And like, honestly, it was a perfectly good meal. It was great.
And most importantly to me, it was the most gluten-free friendly meal I've had in ages. It was tapas. We had a cauliflower crust pizza, flatbread pizza that I've never seen before. It was fantastic.
It was really good. So it's called Barrique. So I want to give it a shout out.
Yeah, it was like the
we
it was
will
like
be
the,
going back.
It was like the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. It's like one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, right there on the south shore of Long Island. Okay.
We will be back. Yes.
We will be back to Barack, and we will be back to this story at the end of the podcast. But why don't we do some notes now, Rachel?
Yes. Okay. So the first thing we usually have to get off our chests is the dry heaves. And there's a lot to talk about in this segment this week. The biggest thing involves this FACACTA Trump appointed Department of Justice official named Jeffrey Clark, who you know, was just sort of a random bureaucrat, but he was in the news because the former attorney general, Jeffrey Rosen, the guy who replaced the acting guy who replaced Bill Barr after he resigned, wound up testifying last week before the Senate Judiciary Committee for 7 hours about how personally involved Donald Trump was in these efforts by certain Department of Justice officials to overturn the election.
This was the first glimpse that we had into like behind the scenes. That's why we're having these hearings, is to like hear from the players themselves. And this is the first time we heard this kind of testimony, right?
Right, exactly. And the key official was this guy, Clark, whose title was like Assistant Attorney General for the Environment and Natural Resources. And not sure if you remember this, but Trump was planning to fire Rosen for not casting enough doubt on the election results, and he was planning on installing this guy Clark, but Rosen and the entire Justice Department threatened to resign, so Trump backed off. And then so there's that, and then there's these insane emails that were obtained by the House Oversight Committee, and they were published by ABC News, and in them Jeffrey Clark is asserting that the reason why the election was unsound and rife with fraud was because votes were changed, wait for it, by Chinese thermostats. Okay, let me elaborate on this. So in an email that was originally sent in December 2020, Clark and his superiors, including Attorney General Jeffrey Rosen, Acting Attorney General, and his deputy Richard Donahue, to look into, quote, foreign election interference issues. And so then Clark claims that hackers had evidence that a, quote, Dominion machine accessed the internet through a smart thermostat with a net connection trail leading back to China.
So the thermostats were not in China. It's not as if they were like Chinese Communist Party people, apparatchiks, like twisting the dials to like move the election votes to Biden. These were the thermostats were the means of transmission.
Yes, they were the nodes in the in the matrix. So he sends this email. He says he hopes to use the information gathered by U.S. intelligence to determine whether these thermometers could make digital contact with voting machines and ostensibly with voters in the United States. And Richard Donahue
mind control? Like, what are the thermostats like causing people to vote in a certain way?
I mean, it's so... It's so beyond anything that is rational that I don't even know what to say about it. So Richard Donahue says, there is no chance that I would sign this letter or anything remotely like it. While it may be true that the department is investigating various irregularities in the 2020 election for president, something we typically would not state publicly, the investigations that I am aware of relate to suspicions of misconduct that are of such a small scale that they simply would not impact the outcome of the election. So basically, and you know, the thing is that Rosen and Donahue are not like these like upstanding, like it's just sort of like there, but for the grace of God go I, that like democracy survived this. And they basically said to Trump, I can't go for that.
No, can do.
Right? I mean, yeah. So that was one of the things that happened this week in the dry heaves. The other thing is this expert mathematician, Ed Solomon, resurfaced. He's the guy who Trump supporters have been quoting and clinging to as the guy who has the statistics that show it's
statistically impossible that Joe Biden won the election.
Yes.
Because of bloop, 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 whatever algorithm he thinks he has, right?
Yes. And this has been like gone viral all over the internet, this guy and his theory. So what happened was on January 27th, the network OAN broadcast a segment where this expert mathematician, so-called, named Ed Solomon, who claimed to have found evidence within precinct-level reporting that the election was rigged by an algorithm. The mathematician said he found several precincts throughout the country reporting exactly the same results at various times throughout the vote tabulation process. And so then Solomon's asked by the journalist on the quote-unquote journalist on OAN if it's possible that these findings could be a coincidence. And he replies, you can use the binomial probability formula and the chance of that event happening is 1 over 10 to an exponent so large that there's not enough stars in the universe. There's not enough atoms in the universe to explain the number.
Wait,
can't happen naturally. Does that make sense to you?
Wait, isn't that binomial theorem something you learn in like eighth grade algebra?
What is the binomial probability formula? Like, there's a binomial equation.
Yes,
right?
That's what I'm thinking of, right? Isn't that like y equals mx plus b? Like, it's the
yes.
slope of a curve?
The slope of a curve, something like that. Yeah, or like x plus 1 equals y plus 2. Anyway, so the binomial probability formula, that is just mumbo jumbo nonsense. Yep. And so, okay, so then
where did he learn all this? Like, what, in what sense is he, what are his credentials? How is he an expert mathematician?
Well, we're getting to that. So, like, and also, I think beyond that, what he's saying does not seem at all odd. Like, wouldn't various precincts at one point have the same vote shares if, like, those shares are going up in different, like,
yeah, well, yeah, it's almost like Brownian motion. There's like 10,000 districts and they're all moving around up and down, and every millisecond, every time a vote gets registered, the ratio changes. Are they going to cross paths sometime? Yeah, you don't need
of course they are.
You don't need the Pythagorean theorem to figure out that, like, yeah, it's probably going to happen.
It's probably like 100% probability going to happen at some point.
But,
and so, okay, so if it makes no sense what he's saying, it's because Ed Solomon, shockingly, is not actually a mathematician. So this is all according to a lawsuit that voting machine company Dominion filed against OAN. Dominion, the one that's, you know, getting the signals from the Chinese thermostats. So Solomon is actually not a mathematician, but a convicted drug dealer and was working as an installer at a swing set company in Long Island at the time of the OAN interview.
Okay? He worked at Jones Beach. They have playgrounds there.
Who is more qualified than a former convicted drug dealer and swing set installer?
Sure.
No.
They really talk about the dry heaves, like literally.
It's like, just the dregs. It's the dregs. Like, this guy who was like the environmental deputy attorney general is like weighing in on like networks run by thermometers. And here we have like an installer at a swing set company saying there's not enough stars in the sky or atoms in the universe to explain Joe Biden's victory.
Rachel, every time I think we should retire dry heaves because like we've reached the bottom of the bile ducts, somehow we turn up nonsense like this.
We plumb new depths every week. Things get worse and worse. So, and you asked about his credentials. According to a fact check.org review of Solomon's segment, his mathematical expertise is limited to have taken a few math classes at Stony Brook University. He never received a degree.
Another fine Long Island institution.
It is.
I took some math classes too. I took AP math, AP calculus. I got a 5
over the summer. Yeah, yeah, why not get those credits out of the way? You don't want to deal with that in college, you know? So okay,
no.
And Solomon, I can't go for that.
No can do. Nope. Well, look, are we replacing all of our nopes with a Hall & Oates catchphrase?
Let's do it. Okay. If we weren't going to, I think
we're committed to our art. We're all in. We haven't discussed this, but sure, I could go with the flow. Okay, so I'm about to plumb the depths deeper into the dry heave. This story is so stupid, I can't even believe I'm talking about it, but I read it.
That's everything we talk about.
It's the only things we talk about. This is in the Daily Beast. least, which I will quote liberally. So when you ask anti-vaxxers, or they're, I mean, I don't know any, so I don't ask them anything. But if when you see them on TV, you ask them why, and they say they don't want to put things in their bodies unless it's been proven safe by the FDA. And you wonder, they don't trust the CDC, but they do trust the FDA. I don't know. So they don't trust the Pfizer vaccine. They don't trust Moderna. They don't trust J&J. But what do they trust? And what are they now putting into their bodies? Something called horse paste.
Horse paste?
It's called horse paste, which is definitely not FDA approved.
Is it like ketamine?
It is not paste made from horses. It is an anti-parasitic drug that you feed to horses, and it is called invermectin.
And what does this have to do with COVID?
Why does any of these, what does hydrochloroquine have to do with COVID? Nothing.
So they're asking for horse medicine to inoculate them?
I'll get there. So these people, so there's all these Facebook groups around it, and they're so avid. One woman on there said, I would sneak horse paste into the hospital and would rub it into the armpit myself to save a loved one. Which led me to research, is that the approved application of horse paste, is rubbing it into the deodorant? Can you get deodorant in horse paste flavor? I don't know.
And do you rub it into the horse's armpit? Is that how?
Horses have armpits? They just have that like foot pits, like arm leg pits. I don't know. So there's this Texas poison control worker who very rightfully says, this isn't funny. The irony is, in a severe ivermectin overdose, patients will end up needing to be intubated to protect their airway. Meanwhile, a lot of them are taking the ivermectin to allegedly treat their COVID to avoid ultimately being intubated and placed on a ventilator. So common sense there. So the problem, it turns out, because I dug deeper, as did the Daily Beast, the problem is not so much the taking of the horse paste, but the dosage. It's very hard to calibrate how much you should take. And the problem is that it's made for very large animals. And, right. So the Facebook groups are obsessed with figuring out the right dosage. So there's questions like, what dosage should I give my 8-year-old? Which is really burying the lead. That really should not be the question of how much to give my 8-year-old. The question is,
Should you be giving this to anybody?
Right, and there's all these like infographic charts of how many, they call it notches, how many notches to take, because apparently it's in a tube and the tube has notches on it.
Oh my God,
and you're like,
this is
I'm
so
on a
stupid.
Notch a day. Right. So the same poison control worker said this form of ivermectin is a 1.87% paste, and it's sold in delicious apple flavor. Uh-huh. I guess to get the horses to eat it. They like apples.
But so then they don't rub it on their armpits.
No,
they put it in their mouth.
I mean, maybe it's good to have apple flavor in your armpits. I don't know. It's they say it's so concentrated because it's formulated for 1,500-pound horses, not humans. Unless someone knows what they're doing, it's very easy to overdose on the paste. So now the next question is, you might ask is, where are they getting the horse paste? The answer, of course, is on Amazon. And the reviews, they're tipped off to which is the real deal by these like coded reviews that are not very heavily coded. So here's an example of such a review. It says, my quote horse had no negative side effects, and now he tells me he feels like $1 million and is now COVID free. So the horse told them that they feel like $1 million. If you are intelligent enough to be able to weigh yourself and smart enough to do fractions, you can do this safely.
No, it's not true, because it's not, it doesn't work like that.
None of it. None of it works like this. People are morons.
It's not like, oh, I'm taking like a full Tylenol and my son is like a quarter of my body weight, I'll give him a quarter of one.
No, it doesn't work like that. So anyway, because it's so available on Amazon, they're selling out and there's a shortage now. So they're going to other versions of the same drug that are not for horses. So there's now a very hot market for parrot paste.
Oh God. For the same parasite?
Which is only supposed to be used for pet parrots. But the problem is that it's more expensive per dose because it's sold in smaller quantities.
And is it seed flavored? Or cracker? It's cracker flavored?
Polly won a toothpaste. And then there's another one for sheep that's called sheep drench, like you're drenching your sheep in it or something. So the shortage is driving the whole horse paste world into a frenzy. So then you have to ask, back up, zoom out, and say, who is enabling all this? So they tried to work backwards, great reporting, and there was this Arizona-based pharmacist who was inundated with prescriptions for horse paste. And they asked, what doctor is prescribing these things? And it's coming from a doctor service called America's Frontline Doctors. So what is America's Frontline Doctors? It was founded in 2020 by someone named Dr. Simone Gold, who is currently awaiting trial on charges related to her alleged participation in the January 6th insurrection.
Oh, I saw that person. That name sounded familiar. Yes.
So as her side hustle, she's selling horse paste while awaiting trial. And who is her partner in this endeavor? This is a name that will potentially ring true to you. Her partner is Dr. Stella Emanuel. She's the demon sperm doctor who has professed a belief in aliens and reptilian overlords.
And Madonna is friends with her.
No.
Yes.
Don't even say that. So America's Frontline Doctors is a legit thing. It now offers telehealth consultations for $90, and it directs prospective patients who are calling and looking to get hydroxychloroquine and ivermectin, whatever this is called, horse paste. And they're sending into this other like online pharmacy called Ravku, RAVKOOOOOO, that's based in Florida. So it's this whole racket of like the January 6th crazies and the demon sperm crazies referring to this like fake pharmacy, online pharmacy in Florida. It's a disaster, this thing. You know what I say?
Confederacy of dunces.
You know what I say? Let them take the fucking horse paste.
Take the horse paste. Go for it.
Take it. Take the cow dosage. Take the giraffe dosage. Take as much as you want because
no dose is big enough.
No dose is too small for you idiots. Like, take it and you'll take what you'll get and you'll like it. So yeah. I can't go for this. No can do.
No can do.
Rachel, you have one more before we go into our deep dive.
Yeah, I was going to talk about the great unwashed, like these celebrities have given up.
Oh, I thought the great unwashed was the people taking horse paste. But no, there's no more great unwashed.
There's more great unwashed. These are, you know, our finest living celebrities who are declaring in the press that they have given up on bathing. But it's kind of like, I don't even want to talk about it. I just want to get right into the Hall & Oates.
So okay, let's skip ahead. Since we've done enough hygiene-related content here. Okay. So where we last left the story is that we're doing plane, trains, and automobiles, thanks to the infrastructure bill, to finally get to Jones Beach Theater. And we're driving down this, like, mystical, I don't know what it was, Robert Moses Highway or something. And it was, like, it was very magical as we were approaching. And then it was, like, a city on a hill, a shining city that came, and it was the Jones Beach Theater. And as a treat for the birthday, I invested in the VIP parking, so we drove past this like Pets on Parade of people, the great unwashed, like who had to park in Field 8 and walk 3 miles to get the thing. We cruised right in, and then we had like we got to walk right in without waiting on the lines, except it didn't actually save us any time because the like I had e-tickets because that's what you get now, right? And like I showed my e-tickets to the girls at the door who were like 12, and they're like, oh, that's not a ticket. And I'm like, it's right there, it has like a QR code, and it's exactly what an online ticket looks like. And she's like,
it was a paperless ticket, which is what everybody's doing these days. Yeah,
right. And she's like, oh, I need a piece of paper. And I'm like, no, yeah. Meanwhile, there's people cruising past me showing their phones. And I'm like, no, yeah. I'm like, it's 2021. No, I don't. What's a paper ticket?
Paper.
A paper ticket anyway. And like,
where
so
do you even get a paper ticket? Like,
right.
What is
and it's
that?
Like, it's just great. Like, you have one job: scan my fucking phone and let me into the concert. So we wound up standing there for God knows how long
Squeeze was performing.
So we're sitting there eager. They were the quote unquote opening act. That's quite an opening act, right? I would go to see them playing. And like they're playing Tempted, which is like their number one song of all time. We're standing there in like the tent trying to argue our way into a a concert that I paid hundreds of dollars for the ticket store, and they're not letting me in because I don't have a slip of paper.
And anyway. Meanwhile, we had the whole like thing unlocked. We had every premiere ticket, every like, and we're just bottlenecked at the ticket entry. It's ridiculous. Yeah.
No, meanwhile, the Pets on Parade were cruising past us, and we were sit there like idiots. But we finally got in. We got to our seats. They were amazing. And we definitely, well, we were, I was worried that whenever I go to a concert, I go to a lot of shows of like young alt indie bands, and I feel a little old. We were definitely not the oldest people at this concert.
No, we were on the young side, which like made me feel more comfortable that everyone was vaccinated.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, you know what I didn't do? I meant to do this. That I realize a lot of our younger listeners may not really know who Hall & Oates are. They may have heard the name. I'm going to play a song that you'll know. Probably, if you know any, You Make My Dreams Come True, because it's been in a lot of movies and it's in the popular culture. So here's a song that you'll know. And if you had any wonders how big Hall & Oates are we just inflating this because they're meaningful to us? No, they had something like 6 number one hits. They had 15 top 10 hits, and they are the biggest duo selling musical act of all time, bigger than Simon and Garfunkel. So they're
hit makers. Everything they did was a huge sensation. Yeah.
They did the song you just heard, but they also did Private Eyes, Kiss on My List, Sarah Smile, Man-Eater. Rich Girl, Maneater, I Can't Go for That, No Can Do, which we've been singing on this podcast. So so they're absolutely amazing. And Rachel, you thought they looked good, right?
I thought that they did, you know, for their age, they had a lot of energy. I felt like they came out and they saw this huge crowd there to see them. And they were a little bit like verklempt for a moment.
Yeah.
It seemed like they didn't quite know what to say. Yeah.
At first I thought I was like, I mean, Daryl Hall was kind of babbling and I was like, is he on cocaine? Because he was like revved up and babbling about nonsense. And there was one song, he's like, this is our demented squirrel song. And like, and I didn't know what he was talking about. But I think your theory is right. I think he was just he's a normal human like all of us. And he looked out on the crowd and he said, we're back.
We're back. The pandemic it's not over, but it's certainly a step in the right direction that they are here performing. And it's a big deal. New York crowd, you know, very cool.
Jones Beach is iconic. That's where Song of Norway was recorded.
Song of Norway.
In his mind, he had echoes of Freddie and his fiddle going through his
big
mind.
Big shoes to fill.
So, I you take a lot of little video snippets of your favorite songs that, you know, basically people go to concerts not to watch the concert, but to take video now. So I'm guilty of that too. I criticize it, but I do it. And I went back when I got home and I watched some of my favorite clips to relive the magic merely 2 hours later. And every time there was a good shot and a good song, after about 10 seconds, an arm waved into the frame and like stayed there and just kind of swayed. And then I had this like PTSD flashback to the thing that I forgot, which was this willow woman in front of us.
Yes. You were very annoyed by the willow woman. And she was more like, you were sitting to my left and she was like in front of you and to the left. So she wasn't in my field of view as much. And I was like, whatever, Brian, you're overreacting. Like, cause he kept being like, this woman is so annoying. And I then realized that she was that annoying.
Okay, so why was she a willow woman?
She was this tall woman who looked kind of willowy, and her arms were up in the air at all times, swaying in a C shape to the left and then a C shape to the right. And then it was like a contagion. Yes. And then her entire row was doing this move. And it was just like, it was this weird wiggle waggle.
Psychedelic. It's like she was like tripping at a dead show, but it was fucking Hall and Oates. Like, there's no reason to sway like that.
There's no reason to sway.
And I mean, it was her only move. It was her signature move. It was like the Elaine dance.
Except, except the worst part about it for me was that once I started noticing her movements, I started noticing the back of her head, and her hair was like so dry. I just wanted to put like a moisturizing mask on it.
On her hair?
On her head. By the end of the concert, her hair would be
this
nice.
Poor woman. All she wanted to do was come to the show. And here we are making fun of her on an international podcast.
She just like blows like the wind. She doesn't care. She's the Willow Woman. She will
forever be the Willow Woman. And then, well, it's funny that you said that she had dry hair, because I started getting texts from concerned friends and family members that said, oh my God, take cover, like a hurricane
is coming. It's about to rain, a hurricane's coming, yes. And the people sitting behind us had the same app as us and were looking at the storm. They were tracking the storm and they were like, it's gonna be here in 14 minutes, that's it.
Right,
that's
and it. You could see like one of those like radar maps moving, and it was like blood red, like coming towards, barreling towards us across the city. And Doug texted me and said, it's pouring here, you're gonna get drenched. And we, at some point, we were like, are they even gonna go on? Are they gonna come on? Are they gonna rain date it? Are they gonna cancel it?
Yeah, because this was in between Squeeze and Hall & Oates, and there was like this long pause. And we're like, maybe they're like, they have like some kind of like meteorologist sorcerer backstage like advising them whether to go on or not.
They're so old that like maybe they would melt. Like they've had a lot of work done, I bet. So like maybe it's not water resistant. By the way, before we get, Daryl Hall is 75 years old. Can you believe
that? He looks great. For 70, he looks really great. He was wearing like a cool outfit. He seems like really, like his voice sounded really good. They had to change some of the arrangements because he can't get as high as he used to. But
although I have to say, like really John Oates didn't look quite as good. He needs to moisturize.
He was a little worse for wear. Oh, and also we didn't talk about the Oaties. There were like Oates fans in the audience who were like wearing fake mustaches in solidarity with Oates.
Solidarity with the cause.
So yeah, there was like this girl in our row who was wearing a mustache, and I was like, oh, okay, I guess this is what like hardcore like John Oates fans do. This is what they do.
Yeah, and I was wondering like if they sold them at the merch table, like maybe I would go buy one. Yeah, nobody would know what the hell I was doing. It's the one place in the world that you can actually wear an Oates mustache and have people appreciate it. Otherwise, you're just a weirdo. So anyway, the rain never came. It was like God intervened.
The power of music. That's the thing. Like it went around us. It's pretty crazy.
The seas parted. The hurricane parted. There was not a, it was completely dry. Of course, the skies opened up when we drove home, but that was like a different story.
It waited. It held off. It was truly like an act of God, you know? Like,
so they were amazing, but the only criticism I have of the show is that it was too short. It was like an hour and 15 minutes, which for a headline act that honestly could have played for 3 hours and only played top 10 hits, it was a little short for me. I would have liked to have had a little more. I mean, it was the most expensive hour I've ever spent. It was...
but it was really good. They were great. So we just have to like appreciate it. And if they went longer, we would have gotten stuck in the rain. So
good point. Let's look at the bright side. Glasses half full. And those girls who couldn't find our tickets on the way in, they were well gone by the time we got out. We cruised right out and got back to Long Island City very quickly.
And everyone's mustache stayed dry. It was
all's well that ends well. Okay, so if you had wondered how our Hall & Oates concert was, that's how it was. Okay.
That's how it was. Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to the ups. These are little rays of light, little beacons of hope that got us through the week. Rachel, what is yours?
Okay, well, besides Hall & Oates, my yup goes to Kathy Hochul, who's New York's first female governor.
Yay!
I actually met Governor Hochul at an event. In a week. I met her at an event for Vote Mama, which is this great organization that helps moms with young kids run for office, and she seemed really great and really smart. So I'm excited. Kudos to you, Governor.
All right.
And designate.
And as foreshadowed, my yup goes to the bucolic Long Island town of Babylon, which we've, you know, very short-sightedly made fun of. We thought it was going to be
this dumb.
Because
it seems so random. It was like, we'll meet in Babylon. What's there to do there?
Amazing, tree-lined, quaint. It was like Stars Hollow in Gilmore Girls. It was just beautiful. There was like a local meat purveyor and all kinds of cafes and funeral parlors and
artisanal coffee. And yeah, I mean, I'm going to be coming back.
I might buy a house there. I mean, if you're in West Hampton and I'm in the city, I would meet you there like halfway. Like that would be a fun place to meet.
I have a house there. I just don't know where it is. Kind of like
me
on...
too. You can be Erica.
It's a housewives joke.
Sorry, we promise not to make those. Okay. Well, wow. It was a terrible week except for the Hall & Oates concert, but it was a really fun podcast to record. Thank you for hearing us talk about it. I hope you enjoyed it. If you've enjoyed this podcast, please rate, subscribe, review, tell a friend in real life. Turn to your Oates fan with the mustache standing right next to you. Talk to the Willow Woman and tell her, please listen to our podcast.
Tell anyone. Stop swaying and moisturize her hair.
Okay. Thank you for listening. This has been Nope. I cannot
the
go for that.
Where we
shut it down. Wait, no, we're not doing it that way, Rach. Okay. This is how people know that this is not scripted because we fuck things like that up. Okay. I say thank you for listening to Nope. I can't go for that.
I can't go for that. No can do.